welcome to The Art of Being Human. I'm going to start today kind of as a sequel to what I did last segment, and I'm going to go into the treatment of diabetes. We're going to do that first. At some point, I'm going to go into the complications that you can get if you don't take care of yourself, new treatment methods. I know they've been trying to find a way that you would be able to check your blood sugar without stabbing yourself with these little lancets and getting a blood drop that you have to put into the meter or put on a test strip and get your blood sugar that way. There should be easier ways to do it, and I know that they are trying to work on those ways, but that's not perfected yet. So let's start off with the treatment of diabetes. What happens first? So you've been diagnosed with diabetes, and you're in a state of shock because you didn't know you had it. Even though you suspected you might have it, it's still a shock to learn that you have it. And what usually happens first is they're going to try, unless your blood sugar is very, very high, they're going to try to control it with diet and exercise. So that starts the whole thing rolling, diet and exercise. That works for some people. It works for some people for a period of time, and then they have to go to pills because diabetes is progressive and it gets worse with time. So at some point, you have to go to pills. Now, I'm going to go over the pills, but sometimes these pills will work for years. In my own case, I took Diabeta. I took it for 13 years. I've been diabetic for about 27 years, something like that. I can check on the date at some point, but I know approximately when I was diagnosed. And I used the pills, Diabeta, for about 13 years. And what happened was the pills became less and less effective, so the doctor prescribed more and more and more. So I was taking several a day instead of one or two. And after a while, you have to admit the pills are no longer working, and then you have to go on into the insulin. Some of these pills are called sulfonylureas, and these pills try to force the pancreas to produce more insulin. The pancreas is checking out, basically. It's producing less and less and less, and at some point it's not going to be functioning at all. But just because you don't get insulin from it doesn't mean that it's not working at some point, because it also produces digestive juices that are important, but the insulin always comes from the pancreas. So these pills will sometimes work for a few years. It forces the pancreas to produce insulin that it doesn't normally produce because it is slowly shutting down. And then the pancreas fails and those pills no longer work. And then you have to go to the insulin. Here is a list of insulin pills. There are about a dozen. I don't know if I have them all here, but there are about a dozen types of pills that people take when they first become diabetic and they go on into that pill stage. And I'm only going to give the brand name, not the original manufacturer's name, but the brand name that we're more or less familiar with, how often it's taken, and how long it lasts. Because what happens is you take the pills, they peak, they help, and then they kind of fade out. Now, Oranase, you take it two or three times a day, and it lasts usually for about 6 to 12 hours. Diabinase, take it once daily, and it says it lasts for 60 hours. I checked on this, and this is what it says. If you take it once a day and it lasts for 60 hours, and you're taking it every day, you're getting quite a bit because it's lasting for a very, very long period of time when you consider that, you know, you only have 24 hours in a day. You have Tolinase, one or two times daily, lasting for 12 to 24 hours. Diabeta, take one or two times a day, and it lasts for about 16 to 24 hours. Amaryl, once daily, lasts for about 24 hours. Glucophage, which is metformin, really, you take two or three times daily, lasts for 4 to 8 hours. Resulin, one daily, lasts for 24 hours. Precoce, three times daily, with meals, lasts for 4 hours. Glyphat, three times daily, 4 hours, and prandin three times daily for 4 hours with your meals. Some you have to take with the meals, others you don't have to take with the meals. That's about it for the pills. Now, what do the pills actually do? I'm not going to go over each individual pill and tell you what it does, because you're never going to remember it. And I don't think it's important, because you're not taking all of those 12 pills. You're just taking one or two of them. But here's what they do, and I'm talking in a general sense. Some of them keep the liver from releasing too much glucose. You really realize that the liver produces sugar and stores sugar. It stores sugar in fat. And if it senses that you don't have enough sugar in your system, it pours it in. Unfortunately, it doesn't know how to stop. The insulin that you would normally get if you were not a diabetic would stop it at the appropriate time. But since you don't have the insulin and the pancreas isn't working, it just keeps producing and producing and producing, and your blood sugar gets very, very high because it does not know how to stop itself. Eventually it does stop, but only long after it needs to stop. So some of these pills stop the liver or try to stop the liver from releasing too much glucose. So the site of the action is in the liver. Some of the pills make muscle cells more sensitive to insulin. Some of the cells become resistant to insulin. And exercise helps, and sometimes you have medication that helps the cells absorb the insulin that you do have so that your blood sugar doesn't get quite as high. So the site of the action is the muscle cells. Some of the pills slow the digestion of carbohydrates so you don't spike so high, and the site of the action is going to be the intestines. Now, what diabetes tends to do, and I should mention it here while I think of it, it tends to slow digestion. And I know when you first get diabetes, they'll say, take the insulin before you eat, that it's acting as you eat, and that's better for you because it won't spike, your blood sugar won't spike so high maybe. But the problem is your digestion slows down as the disease progresses. And so with myself and with people who have slow digestion, it's suggested that you can take the insulin after you eat. What you need to do, if you're curious about it, is ask your doctor, when should I take the mealtime insulin, before or after I eat? You know, if you're in a restaurant, I think it's foolish to take the insulin because you've ordered. You might be a half an hour before you get your food. They may be late. It may be 40 minutes before you get your food, or you may get it right away. You would not take your insulin until the food arrives or you know it's on its way because you can see the waitress carrying it in. You know, don't take it too soon because it's going to reduce your blood sugar and you may find yourself crashing before you even have a chance to eat. So you have to use some common sense about that. But anyway, sometimes these pills will slow the digestion, and that makes it easier for the insulin to catch up with it. Some insulin causes the pancreas to release more insulin than it normally would because it's shutting down. And the site of the action will be the pancreas. And I've also mentioned the sulfonylureas. They cause the pancreas to release more insulin. And I mentioned before, and I want to repeat again, I think sometimes it is better to start the insulin sooner rather than later. The reason being that the pancreas is shutting down. It's losing its beta cells. It's just not going to be able to produce insulin. And if you force it to produce because you're taking pills that make it produce, then after a while, it just can't do it anymore. And therefore, you may as well be type 1 diabetic because you're not going to get insulin. It can't do it. So what some doctors have done is start little doses of insulin when a person is kind of showing signs that they're going to be diabetic and they can affirm that's the fact because the blood sugar is rising too much. Give little doses of insulin, not a lot. And then that rests the pancreas. The pancreas gets rested, and it's not frantically trying to create insulin that it doesn't have because it's being forced to by a pill. It can rest, produce what it can, and the slack is taken up by the insulin injections that you get. And therefore, that helps the pancreas to function for a much longer period of time than it would if you're just forcing it by pills to produce more and more and more until it finally just basically collapses and it can't do it anymore. But that's my opinion, and there has been some research evidence to show that children, if they're going to become diabetic, and it's known for sure their parents are diabetic, they're on that track for diabetes, to give them small doses of insulin, and the pancreas actually stays functioning for a much longer period of time. The problem with adults is the fact that they're not going to want to take an insulin shot. I can't imagine children wanting to do it either, but you know, they've been living their lives without insulin, and they don't want to start using a needle. But if you take the insulin, you will feel much, much, much better because your blood sugar will be in control like it should be for a much longer period of time. Do not hesitate to take insulin if it's required of you or if your doctor suggested. I was like most people. I didn't want to do it, and we put it off and we put it off and we put it off. Meanwhile, I was feeling sicker and sicker and sicker. And when I finally said, okay, I think maybe we should start it, my doctor gave me the high fives, and he said, you will feel much better. And I did within a relatively short period of time. But it does take getting some used to, getting up and doing an insulin injection around the time that you eat, always having to carry it with you. It's a pain. It really is a pain. But you do feel much better on it than not. Now, there are different types of insulin. You have the rapid acting, the short acting, the intermediate acting, and the long acting. And it is not unusual for people who are diabetics to take two or three of these types of insulin. So that I take two shots of Lantus, and I take five shots. I check five times a day. I take at least three or four shots of Humulog and two shots of Lantus. It's not too unusual for a person to take a combination of rapid acting or short acting and long acting. The short acting gets to your blood sugar right away. The long acting just spreads it over time so that you have a much more even blood sugar. Each starts within minutes. With the insulin, each type of insulin starts within minutes to work, or minutes to an hour or so after the injection, and then they peak, and then they gradually subside. So you have to know what your insulin is doing, but that's up to your doctors to tell you. Now, when they do this depends upon the type of insulin that you're taking. And many types of diabetics take two or three types of insulin. Now, let's talk about the insulin. The type and the duration. Rapid acting insulin starts in about 15 minutes to work. It peaks in about an hour, and it lasts for about 4 or 5 hours. It just phases off. Short acting starts at about 5 minutes to an hour. It peaks in 2 or 3 hours, and it lasts from 4 to 6 hours. Now, that depends upon the type of insulin that you're taking. I'm only giving you kind of like the rule of thumb here. Intermediate acting insulin starts around 2 to 4 hours after you've injected it, because it's not going to start right away. It's going to take on and start taking care of the blood sugar when the short acting insulin starts to fade out. So it kind of takes over as one leaves, the other begins, so that you have a more even blood sugar level. And the purpose of taking the insulin and the time you take it and how much you take and what kind you take, the purpose is always to try to get your body to mimic, to be like a normal body, to take your body with the insulin that you get from the injections to be like a normal body in terms of how it responds to natural insulin if your pancreas was working. So intermediate starts 2 or 4 hours after the injection. It peaks in 4 to 10 hours, lasts from 10 to 16 hours, and the long-acting starts at 6 to 10 hours after you take it. It peaks 14 to 24 hours, and it lasts 18 to 20 hours. So as I said before, the purpose of it is to get your body to be like a normal body in the way that it responds to insulin. The insulin needs to be kept in a cool refrigerator, but that's not 100% true. Usually, it's true. An unopened bottle of insulin should be kept in the refrigerator. You cannot freeze it. If you freeze it, it will be destroyed. You cannot use it. You can't get it too cold. You can't get it too hot. So I add this, do not freeze the insulin or you'll be, it's just a waste of money. Bottles of insulin that are in use can be kept at normal room temperature for up to a month. So if you have a bottle of insulin that's open because you're using it, and it's going to last, say 10 or 15 days or whatever, you don't have to put it back in the refrigerator as long as it's in normal room temperature. If you haven't used the insulin and you're just keeping it until the time when you need to use it, keep it in the refrigerator. If it's going to take longer than a month to use it up, keep it in the refrigerator. But if you have a bottle out and you're going to use it within a month, you do not have to put it back in the refrigerator. That's kind of the rule of thumb. Open bottles, if you keep open bottles in the refrigerator, they will last for about 3 months. So if you have a bottle of insulin that you're opening, that you're using, but it's going to take you longer than a month to use it up, then it should go back in the refrigerator. Keep insulin away from the sunlight. Never put it in the sun. Never leave it on a windowsill. Do not let insulin get too hot or too cold. It will be destroyed. And during the summer, you must take and keep ice packs with it. Now, I'm going to close it here because I want to get started on brittle diabetes. Well, maybe I can get done brittle diabetes. Brittle diabetes hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia is like the opposite of diabetes, but I won't be able to get to that till next time. Brittle diabetes, what is it? You hear about people who are brittle. I'm brittle. And when I was diagnosed, I knew it was just, that's the way it was going to be. I just knew. Well, how would I know? There's no reason I would know, but I just knew. Sometimes you have that inner sense. What happens in brittle diabetes is that you have wide swings in blood sugar numbers, and some people go from very high and very low, and they swing back and forth. And there's no known reason why they should do that. That's just the way that their bodies are going to act. When I had my quadruple bypass, of course, you're under terrible stress when you have surgery, and your body does not know how to handle it. So if you're diabetic, it makes it even worse. I was going from 50, which is practically coma level, to 500, which is coma level, swinging back and forth. And I knew when I was going down, because I would get the symptoms, I'd call a nurse and they would give me stuff to eat, you know, and it would build it up. But then they would check it and they'd be up to 500. And so I stayed in the hospital a lot longer than I might have had to because I could not get control as to what my body was doing. Being diabetic and having heart surgery on top of that, that is not a cool thing. But that's what you have to do sometimes. Some people go from high to low and they do it quickly. Now it can be caused by food not being absorbed in the same amount of time every day that you eat. Or the insulin may be absorbed at different rates, or stress can cause the release of stress hormones, and that makes it difficult for the insulin to work. Or you may have an exaggerated response to food, medication, and stress. It could be anything like that. I personally think it's in the genes. If you're going to be swinging high and low, I think that's a part of the disease. Some people do that and some people don't. If you don't, you're much better off. People can inject the same dose of insulin at the same time of day, eat the same food, never change, and find that there's a terrific difference in their blood sugar numbers for no known reasons. Some people think it's the timing of the injection, or if you measure your dose accurately, or rotation of injection sites. There are various places you can inject yourself if you're diabetic. You're not supposed to be using the same site all the time. You're supposed to rotate. Some people don't rotate enough. But the most consistent blood sugar reactions is if you inject yourself in the abdomen. That makes it most consistent. The depth of the injection might make a difference. Do you use the same depth? I think you would. You inject the whole needle down to where it stops. And you can have neuropathy. Neuropathy is a problem. It changes the nerves, and that influences the way that you digest food and the time it takes. If you have also room temperature, I just want to mention that, and then I'll close with it. If you are in a cool room, your absorption of insulin will be slower. If you are in a warm room, your absorption of insulin will be faster. Remember, when you get it in you in the injection, it still has to go into the bloodstream. You're doing it subcutaneously. You're injecting into a muscle, but then it still has to get into the bloodstream. How long does it take to get there? Well, not very long, but if you're in a cool room, it'll take a little longer than if you're in a warm room. And one thing, while I think of it, if you crash, then of course you have to have something quickly to eat to bring you back up, so you don't go into a coma. Anyone who's diabetic will know what I'm talking about. Don't use chocolate as a sweet to get you up. Use something else. Chocolate digests very slowly. And so if you are about to crash, your blood sugar is too low, you got to grab something to make your blood sugar higher so you don't have those feelings of dizziness and being faint and all of that. Use something that other than chocolate. I know people eat candy bars, and that's a help. But chocolate does digest slowly. You're better off with graham crackers, milk, soda, you know, and stuff like that, because it'll get into the bloodstream a lot faster than if you eat chocolate, especially the dark. It's good for you. The chocolate is good for you, but it's slow to digest, so it takes longer to take the action necessary to get your blood sugar up. I still rely upon my Mountain Dew, and it works really fast. So I'm going to close it here. And we're going to start next time and talk about hypoglycemia, which is a precursor of diabetes. And then I'm going to go into other things. And I'll probably bring in things to show you in terms of what you carry with you, what you do, how it works, what the syringes are, what they look like, what happens, how you get rid of them, and how you take care of yourself. So we'll start that next time. Please join me then.